Welcome to Southside Korero. My name is Vincent Tyra Vitalina. I just done an amazing interview with Mary Owe, or Ms., as she likes to be known online. Mary Owe is an amazing person who manages the amazing group of coconut wireless. She goes through her experiences and just insight of what is it like being in the social media as a Pacific Islander. So without further ado, I hope you enjoy the episode. This is Vincent Tyra Vitalina. Southside Korero. Got it? Welcome again to Southside Korero. My name, of course, is Vincent Tyra Vitalina. I want you to know my full name because we're part of a family. So we, you know, I share my family name and I share it to you beautiful people. Today we're gonna have an amazing guest. I cannot stress this enough. I'm already shaking because I'm just like, huh. We had pre-talks and it was an awesome pre-talk. We have Mary Owe. Oh, you don't mind me saying your full name, Mary?
No, not at all.
Awesome. Like I said, we like to share our full names because our family needs to know who we are. So yay. Welcome to the show, man. Can you please give us a brief intro about yourself and your beautiful work that you do out there in the community?
Okay. Kalofala yatu ko ingo hako ko Mary Owe. Hau au he maanga ko hako puatua mo vaia. Ko tau matua hako ko Don mo mele Owe. I have 6 siblings who are actually, you know, from my parents, and then I've got other siblings that my dad have, you know, yeah. So, yeah, that's basically it. Thank you for the opportunity to come on here today, and it's, you know, accelerating Aotearoa, as you know, is very close to my heart.
Yeah.
So I'm really looking forward to contributing today.
Oh, absolutely. I was just reading before this interview started. I did a little bit of research on you, and wireless coconut is an amazing thing that's happening. And I mind asking how long has wireless coconut has been running since now?
Well, if you don't mind, believe it or not, that's how cousin Judy and I.
Hey!
Met. So it was an e-newsletter many, many years ago. And then, you know, I stopped and helped other people, which was ad hoc. And then, 7 years ago, I found myself unemployed on the benefit. So that's when the social media aspect of Coconut Wireless started. It was initially started to promote scholarships that our community, so it was provided, the scholarships were provided for our communities, but then our communities didn't know about it.
Yeah.
And then, there were amazing products within our community, but our communities, again, didn't know about it, so we needed to support our own business people. We needed to profile how amazing our communities are, simply because during that time, media and the perception of, you know, mainstream New Zealand, they believed that we were unemployed, criminals, lazy, you name it. And what I saw throughout the years were, because our communities didn't actually stand up for ourselves, the misconception was media thought that they could, you know, they recorded fights. They literally, if you look back, definitely 7 years ago, there was so much negativity that actually I got angry about it. Yeah. And the Coconut Wireless social media aspect was, I better not say. basically middle finger to the media, middle finger to anyone else who thinks, you know, there's so much talent.
Absolutely.
So much talent within our Māori and Pacific community. Oh, I get quite emotional and there's so much talent, and you know, Judy has been trying to do this work for a very long time. There's so many different pockets, but it seemed like we were pushing one way and people want us to stay down. So they pushed back. But I think over 7 years, it's been amazing. So, I mean, the growth of Coconut Wireless now, not so much the advocating, because there's a whole lot of communities that now advocate. But what it is just creating the platform.
Yeah.
So that it promotes, because the core of who we are is all about culture. You know, we can exist in this mainstream environment or this Western society. We've spent a lot of, you know, a lot of people have tried to take the culture out of us. A lot of people have tried to take the language out of us. But for us, that is the essence or the, you know, that's part of who we are. And I really want our people to really embrace, please embrace who you are, because you're far richer. You know, with sharing about yourself.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, that's beautiful. I want that raw energy because that's who you are. That's the mana that a lot of people need to bring out in this generation. I don't know how to express my cultural aspects of things, because when you look at this generation and the previous generation, so millennials going forward, we sort of just look like past our culture, and we don't acknowledge it. But but when you look at the South Auckland area, or even further beyond, there's this growth of, okay, my parents are still here, or my grandpapa and my mama are here. Let's learn about the culture that we have, and I love it because they're learning about it as they grow up, and mm-hmm. it's beautiful because I'm learning my culture as well. I'm relearning how to be Samoan, because the far Samoan way, and just because when I was little, I was shamed because I did, like, oh, Samoans, you know. They're good at sports, cool. But then when I got older and I started to realize that there is amazing Samoans out there that are doing beyond the sport realm and beyond the entertainment realm, that are doing beautiful things, that are doing research beyond, you know, the comprehension of what that people who are pushing us down, yeah. We can do amazing things. And the amazing thing is that it's all contained in South Auckland. Let's try and open that up for everyone to see.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
It's like a tinderbox that's ready to explode. And yeah. It's, you know, I just want to say thank you for opening up, like, especially opening up a Coco Wireless, you know? It's just, how can we, the younger society, the younger generation, can open up, and through social media is a perfect way of doing it. So yeah. With social media, what are your current thoughts of the platform today of our young people doing Cook Island dances? I saw someone doing a live of a performance. So yeah, I just want to engage your thoughts on the platform now as it is.
I mean, take 7 years ago, using social media, it's an amazing, powerful tool. And if you think of that, it was actually, at that time, it was actually used to vilify us. So that actually reinforced what media. So what had happened was media was, you know, promoting all the fights and stuff like that. But then we ourselves were filming those fights and actually reinforcing what everyone else was thinking. Yeah. But in actual fact, that's only like a handful of people. And everyone fights. Let's face it, you go down to Scarfy City in Otago, those kids were far worse than our kids in South Auckland. But hey, that's not news, right?
Yeah, exactly. And
what's happening now, what I love about now is, you know, so our grandparents were taught to say, oh no, your ways are backward. Your ways, you know, the devil.
Yeah.
And then our parents, they embraced, you know, Western culture.
The way of thinking, yeah.
And then, you know, come to my age group, we needed to ask permission. So throughout that generation, we needed to ask permission. And what I'm loving our young people seeing is they're now, so, you know, when I first, to give you context, is when I first moved into New Zealand, Pacific people didn't want to be called Pacific. They wanted to be Māori. And that was when the Dawn Raid era happened.
Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't during the Dawn Raid, but the after effect of that, when I first moved into New Zealand, it was no, you know, I used to think it was because they were ashamed to be Pacific, but in actual fact, it was because those Dawn Raids happened and, you know, who are you? You're Māori. Because obviously Māori, mana whenua of this amazing, beautiful Aotearoa. And what I love now is that we now no longer put up with people vilifying us, because now we're taking back our power. Our young people are unapologetic and proud to be Pacific, or proud to be Māori. And look, any young person should be proud of who they are.
Absolutely.
You know, and now we're embracing our cultures. We're seeing, you know, people think that Whā Samoa is actually bad, but actually, no, the true essence of it is not. You know, people think Niueans, you know, are this, or Cook Islands are that, or Fijians are that. It doesn't, you know, the thing is, there's such a beautiful spiritual thing about our languages and our cultures. And it's actually, you know, it's priceless. Yeah, it's priceless. And I, look, the thing is, when you're, you know, if we use culture or our appearance as the anchor of who we are, then we open up a wholesome person. You know, often I hear people, "Oh, who am I? I need to look for myself." It's because they're disconnected from their culture. Yeah. They're disconnected from their family, because, you know, I always use that Avatar movie. When I'm explaining it to people who don't understand, if you watch Avatar and they all connect to this tree, the life force from it, it's the same feeling that I have in terms of, like, I'm Niue born, the connection to the land, it's indescribable. But it's the Avatar movie, you know, if people need to picture it.
Yeah, it's like they intertwine. It's how they basically, their physical touch brings them back to that tree, and that tree is filled with what their everything, their culture, their history, their language.
Yeah. You know, and we need to remember that we do stand on the shoulders of giants, you know. Our ancestors were the greatest navigators, unlike that Captain Cook who went like this and this way. Our ancestors were very strategic, you know. If we look at the way science, technology, not technology in a computer sense, but the way it was, the technology, the engineering, our ancestors did that.
Yeah.
You know, they came from, you know, obviously, you know, faraway lands, but they stopped in some places to replenish their supplies. They stopped and replenished and actually, you know, mixed off the population. And then we ended up here, you know, in the South Pacific.
Yeah.
It's huge.
I love it, because it's just, you hear stories about our ancestors being in Asia and in Europe because of their wonderful navigation skills. And it goes back to just like the...
Exactly.
It goes back to the plain old, where you had mentioned that the generation were told before then how things should be, and then And then the generation then would be like, okay, this is what my generation did. Let's put this forward and try and make it a thing for us to live by. And they went out there in great ships. I just hear stories about it. It's amazing. Because no GPS at the time, I'm sorry, kids.
Exactly.
No,
we used nature, you know. It's really, I just love being Pacific. I love being Niuean. I love being part of our, you know, my own family, our communities. And I love being here in Māngere, and I love being here in South Auckland. I just love people in general, especially people who are just good, wholesome people.
Yeah.
Whose agendas are the betterment of the whole community, not of self. You know, to describe it in a westernized, framework, you know, there's transactional and there's heart.
Yeah.
I am a heart person.
Yeah.
That's our people, right?
Exactly.
That's our people in general. We're heart people.
Yeah. And that's the thing. I really want us to truly unpack what it means to be Pacific and what, you know, and for me, just because I no longer live on Niue, it actually doesn't, there are no borders. And that's what I love about social media. There are no borders. And I really want our, but there's opportunities. There's also opportunities on how technology is. And that's the opportunity for our people to really harness the power that's been gifted to us by our ancestors, to take it back and to truly fly.
Absolutely.
You know? And that's one of those things is, you know, I just want to shout out to Josh 685 because he truly showcased, what it means to be Pacific in that culture. You know, before that, it was the haka who went viral. And before that, you had Talofa Southsiders who represented Tonga, and that's cultural.
Yeah.
So thanks to TikTok, you know, our cultures are getting billion views, whereas, you know, Facebook and Instagram and all those other previous social media platforms, we've got to remember it's actually, they are Bālangi platforms. And they sexualize our content. I mean, I'm on Facebook jail.
Oh, no.
Yeah. You know, most people. So the way I do social media is actually quite different to everyone else because I've been put on Facebook jail. And the only other one student of mine from Papua New Guinea, he's also in Facebook jail. Because, so a lot of the functionalities that everyone else has access to, we can't access because we're on Facebook jail. So we have to look at, I know people going, what's Facebook jail? Oh, it's when Facebook blocks you from doing stuff.
Yeah.
Permanently. So this, look, I just know that social media is the platform. Technology is what will help us take back who we are. Yeah. We can lead. Yeah. We can lead and be part of the innovation that's currently happening. That's been accelerated by COVID-19. Sadly, yeah. But you know it's a catch-22. I'm sad that COVID-19 happened, but at the same time, it's actually realized the world has realized. Oh. We've actually neglected people and focused on materialistic stuff. So, Judy has been in this space and been advocating for technology for a very long time. And a lot of people don't know that she was also part of that pioneering and bringing, highlighting technology. That was when I think technology was 200, you know, in terms of industry, it was about, I think it was 400 at one point and then at 200. And now it's the number one industry.
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, the ranking in terms of salary or, you know, in terms of it's the fastest growing too.
Yeah, I will have to agree with that because I'm part of that field. I'm part of that technology field. I'm a software engineer as well as a network technician. Yay!
Yeah.
I'm a technician. I can fix your internet and for $5. $5? Yeah. If you're going to talk about technology, early 2000s, it didn't exist. You know, New Zealand was already in that bubble of we're already in this farm, we're in the farming industry, tourism industry, we're already in there. And then the boom happened around 2004, and then we were already like broadband was becoming a thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, when you mentioned that, I was like, okay, cool. We're getting into the information of my field of it's booming, and then going back into social media, it needs to get faster and faster.
Yeah,
and it comes back to accessibility, right? Noticing that a lot of our communities do not have the lack of technology access, especially when you look at South Auckland. They barely have the bare minimum necessities of a computer or a laptop or much more of a tablet, and then we get hit with something like COVID.
Well, that truly highlighted the have and have nots, and I have to say that last year was a lesson. This year we're still going through the same thing, and it really concerns me.
Yeah.
Coconut and Wireless, and it's a passion project of mine is South Auckland STEM. But I have amazing people like Ray Cocker from GameTan, Bronnie and Ian and Alan from ShadowNet, they're gamers. And, that's an important component in terms of our program because it is highly interactive. But how do we turn that passion into an actual career pathway? They don't have to be gamers because not everyone is an All Black.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you use that, harness that same passion of, because it is technology, it's just in gaming. And then we have the likes of Koi, who's a deputy principal at, Rise Up Academy. She brings her class into our sessions. Then we have Maria, of course, from Opulence Interiors, and her and her sisters own their own interior home staging company. Then we have our, some of our parents that help out. And then we have some of our tertiary students who are amazing, who are led by Nathaniel and Vincent, Shay. We've got Johnson. And then we've just recently got Anna on board. And then we have our STEM youth who are year nine upwards. They're amazing. So as long the whole family needs to be involved. And we have 250 kids on registration and we can only take 120 at a time because of the space limitation. But we had 72 sign up for the online coding thanks to Coder Ventures. But there's still the difference of our kids. There's still a lot. It was free. It is a cost no more, but because they allowed us, free online coding. Then we had ran online, school holiday program just passed. And a lot of our kids don't have access to devices. I mean, we don't even have access to a lot of devices, but we managed to put a program where it's highly interactive. And so we have an amazing team, but last year I thought that was the lesson. We knew what things were happening. And I find again, when we went to level 4, the same things are not happening. We haven't learned from last year.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what I mean? This is not going to change. This is what's happening in COVID-19. And when digital transformation actually peaks, we're not even there. So instead of device, not having devices, not having access to internet, we're now going to have people unemployed because, their jobs have been automated.
Yeah.
And that's not good enough. No. That's not good enough. We've got to stop being reactive. We need to be proactive. Sorry, I get carried away.
No, beautiful. No, no, this is beautiful.
I get so passionate, and sometimes I get so angry, and sometimes I have a bit of a cry. I mean,
no, that's no.
Judy and I have had a
perfectly
few cries.
Fine. No, that's perfectly fine. It's that's why we made this podcast. It's because we wanted to have these guests to have like pure energy, and we want people to feel it through the microphone or the headphones or. In the manner and love for it and in anger and just feelings in general, because it goes back to the greater cause of understanding and like we explained earlier, the theater of the mind. You paint a picture of what the person is trying to explain, and there is frustration. There is a lot of frustration in terms of just the unequalness when it comes to our people who are still out there with we got amazing technology. We can do this, we can do that, we can connect to our people. But you know, when you go back down to lower grounds, and so I'm sorry to say it is lower ground, you don't have the same equality that a lot of our politicians are spewing out. You know, that's not fair. Why is it that we here, we show love and mana and respect, and we do the things that we need to do, dot our I's and tick our boxes and whatnot. You know, why do we have to do that? And then it goes back to our very important topic, which is vaccines. Mm. So we noticed that there's a, you know, certain groups that our lovely government are hoping that we can get an increase in numbers. So I'm gonna ask questions from then about that. So first and foremost, from a personal standpoint, have you been vaccinated?
Well, I'm getting my second dose at the Niue drive-through. I mean, I've always been pro-vaccination. Growing up in the islands, that is what has saved us. So our whole family has always had that mentality. The only reason I'm the last person in my siblings to get vaccinated, including my I'm the second to last person. Because I'm a pro-vax, you know, that's what happened when, you know, growing up in Niue. We've had all our shots, and that doesn't change. The only reason why I'm, you know, late to come, jumped on late is because I had, you know, I get weather sinuses and sinuses, and you've got to be well to get your vaccination.
I know that feeling.
When it's cold and change of weather, being Pacific, I suffer from sinuses and weather sinuses. So, yeah.
I know that feeling. So I went to go get my second jab. So this was like a month ago. I went to go get my second jab. I had the worst block nose ever. So I'm just going, I'm snorting and doing all that sort of stuff. And I go up to the guy. He knows.
Yeah.
That he's going to say no. Are you sitting there? He can see this head tilt, and he's like, do you have a blocked nose? And I'm like, yeah, I have a blocked nose. He goes, well, can you like go take the test around the corner, and then we'll go back here, like rebook it? And I'm like, but I'm on time. Like, that's not fair. I'm like, but at the same time, like, that's understandable. We want to protect everyone from their, you know, who's doing their job and whatnot. Yeah. So I got the COVID test. Have you done the COVID test as well?
No, I've actually just stayed home.
Oh, good.
I don't go anywhere. I mean, apart from going, yeah. So during level four, my sister was the one that did the shopping.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So okay. When I'm unwell, I actually, that's why I want to move to a warmer climate.
Yeah.
Because I suffer really badly from,
From sinuses and weather.
Sinuses and weather. I don't get the flu. I probably only had like the flu twice in my whole life. I'm very healthy, but when it comes to weather and sinuses, I just can't control it.
I want your immune system, to be honest. I get sick often. I need your immune system. So going back into the conversation we had earlier, I want to add in the social media component into this. The news has their point of view, and the government has their point of view, and then social media as well, especially those who are on the fence and those who are against it, as well as ourselves, who are pro-vaccinated, and I proudly admit that I am a pro-vaccinated and I've got my vaccinations. What are your thoughts of the landscape now in terms of just the big announcement that just happened on Monday? I noticed from both Facebook, Twitter, as well as Instagram, there's a lot of divide. So I just want to get your opinion on that, and what sort of message do you want to give out to those who are on the fence, especially who can't really differentiate between the two sides, because there is a big divide now.
Well, what concerns me, look, while everyone was, handling, so social media has been a thing, and to me, anti-vaxxers have used it as a tool to really, push their message. Not only are they pushing their message, it's actually a lot of it is misinformation. And that really concerns me. So in terms of anti-vaxxing, they've been around for years, and actually it started, back in the US. What people don't understand is there's lack of medical resources back in the Pacific. So they don't have the luxury of, like Australia, for an example. You can be an anti-vaxxer there, and you're going to still be looked after at the hospital if you get sick, right? When you catch COVID. In the Pacific, they don't have that luxury. Even here in New Zealand, because we were part of the measles campaign, it's okay to vaccinate back in December 2019. In 2019, while we were fighting with anti-vaxxers online, they have blood on their hands because, that is also part of the reason that Samoa, sadly, 83 lives were taken, especially our children. And that pro-vaccination, when COVID-19 came into the picture, there were so many conspiracy theorists and anti-vaxxers. And unfortunately for the pro-vaccination, we didn't realize that there's an algorithm that's already, while everyone else have just jumped on board this year, we've spent 2 years, especially, Jason Menu and Jacinda, promoting that pro-vaccination, why it was important.
Yeah.
What concerns me now is, COVID-19 here in New Zealand has affected most Māori and Pacific. We've seen the current rates in terms of, the cluster, that the first one, not the first one, but, a subcluster where our Pacific families suffered.
Yeah.
We were in hospital. We were in IC, we were in MIQs. And now we're seeing our Māori whānau are going through the same. And that's not good. That's not good for us.
Yeah.
We may not have bought the COVID-19, but history tells us that we're the most affected by it. And we will also have higher death rates. The only reason why we're in a unique, a better position than the rest of the world is because of, the government and our health professionals have protected us.
Absolutely, yeah.
And now, that leadership needs our support. Our communities, those of us who are pro-vaccination, you need to stand up and encourage and support your families who haven't done the vaccination. You need to help them understand or even connect them with doctors. We have so many doctors who are willing to help support, and nurses. Help support Dr. Nisi Prescott. Shout out to you, because if you can find her on TikTok and Instagram,
hey,
reach out to our own people. Yeah. Hey, reach out to us. And shout out to our underground pro-vaccination group that I'm part of. So even though I might not see, you know, Kokona Wireless as pro-vaccination, we were doing pro-vaccination 2 years away before everyone else jumped on board. I mean, that's not funny, but, you know.
It's just you've paved the way of something that could
not so much me, but, you know, we've done the message, and it's great to see everyone else jump on board. Shout out to all the amazing, you know, our organizations that are currently supporting our families. There are so many reasons why our families who are, you know, haven't chosen to get the second shot or haven't chosen at all to do the, you know, think about the vaccination. What people don't understand is during the measles, you know, before COVID, it was measles that are affecting. We had actually people nearly dying in the hospital. The only reason why that they didn't die, no one died in 2019 of measles that I'm aware of, was because we had great health professionals and a better health system compared to what was happening in Samoa.
Absolutely.
At the time.
Yeah.
What I also want to encourage everyone, it's really, you know, the government has done their job, all the providers have done their job, or, you know, we all government providers, you know, the amazing team here at Accelerating Aotearoa. We all need to encourage our family members who haven't got their vaccination to get vaccinated. We need to protect our children who can't be vaccinated. We need to protect our elderly, our matures. Yeah. Numbers don't lie. You look at India and what they went through. The only reason why they don't have, you know, their numbers have actually steadied and actually declined was because of that mass vaccination that they did.
Yeah.
The only reason why Samoa measles, you know, the death stopped is because they had that mass vaccination.
A rollout, I remember that.
The only reason why Fiji has got, you know, have actually, and numbers don't lie. And if you're a religious person who's pro, you know, pro God and prayers, yes, it does help. The vaccine, it goes hand in hand with science. We have to trust science. You know, we have to trust science. And if you know, trust your family members. We are in a, like I said, New Zealand did well in purchasing. Sorry.
No, you're all right.
My English is my second language, so I always mispronounce the vaccine. New Zealand did well in purchasing the right to have vaccination for us. So ungrateful that we're alive. And that is not because that was not accidental. You know, our government looked at the numbers, did a forecast if we went through this road. They chose people over business. We can no longer sustain we can no longer keep locking down. The answer to coming out of lockdowns and not going on lockdown is vaccination. And we need to get on board. If not for yourself, do it for your family. If not for yourself, do it for your community. If not for yourself, do it for Aotearoa.
Hey!
Yeah.
I honestly couldn't say anything better. I was going to lead up with a question, but you led that beautifully, and that message should be echoed out to everyone, especially those who are on the fence, you know, and those who, you know, who are unsure. And I like to say this because it is what it is. It's a message of hope. In these times, especially for the last close to now 2 years, we need that message of hope. There's a, you know, you go to media and you go to our traditional medias that our mamas and papas are used to, radio, paper and TV, it's the same dreary news. But then you go to social media and you expect something different, but it's not, it's the same thing. So when you listen to this and you listen to other people who, especially professionals and whatnot, who have this message of hope, it's beautiful because it's like a beacon in the dark that a lot of people can follow and go, hey, look, there's this light. I can sit here alone in the dark, or I can follow that light, follow that beacon where the beautiful people are out there spreading love, truth, and whatnot. And it's, thank you for sharing that. You know, we need it. So we're coming to our last part of our podcast. It's sad because I actually really enjoyed this podcast. It's so so fun. It was amazing. So I got two more questions. One of my last questions is that I sort of changed it up because when I talked to Helen Tor, she put a twist to it, and I was just like,
lovely, ooh. Helen.
Yeah. Oh wow. Okay. So. What would be the advice that you like to give to those who are in these current times is my normal question. But what would you like to say to those who are out there in these current situations? So just like advice or whatnot, because importantly, you know, we heard from you, your amazing story. What sort of message you want to send out to those, or advice, who are currently in these hard times?
I just want to encourage everyone to look after yourselves, reach out, use social media to reach out. Obviously, I don't recommend that you break the law unless you urgently have to, obviously. And we saw that in terms of the flooding. But I really, really want to encourage you to... there is a light after this. We can never go back to pre-COVID. And, you know, I don't see that happening. What you need to do is actually truly seek within yourself and talk to yourself, actually.
Hey.
Just talk to yourself and encourage yourself, because, you know, whatever you're going through, that you're not alone. We're actually going all through it together. Reach out to yourself, you know, reach out to your friends and families if you need someone to talk to. Check in, please check in with your friends just to say hello. I do a simple message. Unfortunately, I can't reach out to everyone. So at the moment, I'm just focusing on in terms of our business, you know, helping out our startups and to navigate through the COVID-19. And you know, one of the things in general, though, is I've slowly but surely just reached out to one person a week. If you have the time, you know, reach out once a day to anybody. But also, if you are the person that reaches out, you need to also have time for yourself. Have that glass of wine, not 10. I do not encourage alcohol, and take it from someone who used to drink a lot. Have one, not 10 or 20.
Yeah, they put the zero in front of the one. Just, it's a one.
Yeah, if you need to go and see your family, do not approach them if you're not allowed in their bubble. There is, you know, walk around your community. Use social media as a means to connect. Join your local group, community group. And, you know, the amazing thing about the community groups, I just want to shout out to everyone who's been admin of those community groups. You guys are real champions.
Achoo.
Yeah, real champions. And keep up the great work and providing a safe space for our communities who are wanting to stay connected. And, you know, the thing is, reach out and please look after yourselves. Yes, you can tell that I've eaten too much taro and corned beef. Stay off the taro and corned beef. I don't recommend it.
I'm just going to say this. That's a healthy Pacific Island diet. I'm just saying. Just that balance.
Not the corned beef, though. Yeah. So, if you look, you can contact me. I can't promise I'll answer straight away, but yeah, just drop me a message. I'll definitely reply back. And yeah.
That's a cool lead on to my last question, to my final question, which is, where can I find you? I know you're Facebook jail, but where can I find you in social media so we can continue this conversation and share the fan of Kobe for Taratai?
You can find me on LinkedIn, Maria Ware. So FYI, online I'm Mez, M-E-Z aware, but on a professional level I'm Maria Ware. So either one of those. Yeah. Or you can reach me via our coconut wireless platforms. All the ones with the coconuts on there. They're actually, I own them, or the communities who from Coconut Wireless Uvea Mo Fortuna, which is Wallace and Fortuna. That community has actually taken that over and they run it the way they want it. So the teams will have a look at your message. If it's the main Coconut Wireless, so we have 700,000 followers and we get thousands of messages. It's not because we don't want to reply back to you. That's just the way. It's just a bit too busy out there.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And find Mary or Meza Wen or Coconut Wireless. We will definitely, especially if you need help. I mean, most of the time we can't personally help you, but we can definitely connect you to amazing people like Judy and yourself, Vincent, to make sure that, we will definitely help you get to to people that we can help you with. So, yeah, that's how you can find me.
Hey, awesome, awesome. Again, I always like to end off with, thank you so much for joining us. And I really mean this. Thank you so much for joining us. You're an amazing guest with beautiful energy flowing. I felt like I was watching an episode of Dragon Ball Z. You're just powering up.
Sometimes I do want to put on my warrior, my warrior armor and go out there and say, please, please do this. Yeah.
Absolutely, and I see that you're already in your warrior armor, because pretty much that you've echoed all the love and mana, and that's your weapon, is that your love and mana goes out there. And to those who are watching, and I'm hoping that your 700,000 people in your group are going to be watching this, will know that we love you and we hope that you're safe. So once again, thank you so much for joining us, and once again, thank you, our lovely viewers and listeners, for listening to our amazing story. This is Southside Korero. Kia ora.
Toe lahi.